All right, thanks for having me. Yeah, all that doesn't change the fact that every day in the studio is quite difficult. So I'm going to give you a little prehistory of the work I've been doing for the past 15 years. First, I'm going to show you the last demo reel I made as a professional animator and compositor in 2004. Working on my own independent projects on the side. And the result of all this for me was that I was working many hours in front of the screen for work that would be presented on the screen. And this had me looking back to the mid-19th century to the zoetrope, which was a physical device for seeing animation. Wildly popular before motion picture film, you probably know. You spin the drum, you look through the slits, and you see the animation pop to life on the inside of the drum. And digital video cameras had just come out on the market, and I got a hold of one, and I realized that the digital video camera, I could spin, this is a simulation of the first test I did on a photograph record, I could spin a sequence of images, and with the right settings on the digital video camera, I could see the animation pop back to life on the sequence, just like the slits of the zoetrope, but using the camera instead of slits. So this was exciting to me because I had been making my own experimental films. I really wanted to get my hands back on the work again and work physically so I could make physical objects, spin them, and shoot them with a digital video camera to make films. So the first big project I did was called Copenhagen Cycles, and I went to Denmark on a Fulbright fellowship, and I went around the city videotaping all the interesting moving elements. Moving textures, canals, flowers in spring, free use city bikes. And I took those video sequences and printed them out on these long strips of inkjet paper and cut the forms out and rebuilt them onto these bicycle wheel sized foam core discs. And then I would take those discs into the studio and spin them in front of the camera and then cut the clips together to make the film Copenhagen Cycles. I think we can go up a little bit on the audio, it's a little bit quiet. Thank you. So I created all these, about 25 different paper sculptures to make the film, and showed those sculptures as kind of a behind-the-scenes, like, expose of the process of making the film at the Sundance Film Festival in 2007, and that was kind of me creeping into, like, gallery spaces, but really still from, like, how the film was made point of view. So on the outside of the space, you see these animations playing on these flat screens, and then you go into the gallery space and you see both static and spinning sculptures, and you realize that the animation on the outside of the gallery space is actually being happening in real time with these cameras that are pointing at these spinning sculptures and feeding those monitors. And then when I was in Copenhagen, my family and I took a train trip through Europe, and one of the stops we made was in Berlin. And this is kind of the scene of the next project. While we were in Berlin, I was really struck by how Berlin holds on to these dark memories of their past from World War II. The wall and this bombed out cathedral downtown called, nicknamed Broken Tooth, which is attached to a Holocaust memorial. And it's also this prosperous, artistic green city. Like, this is a giant foosball table in one of the city squares. I'm playing with my father-in-law here. And so I started to think about that that swing between war, peace, war, destroy, create, destroy. We keep finding ourselves in this is kind of in the midst of the Iraq war. And so the next project, I started to think about using a concertina, which is a little accordion that has great expressive potential and it breathes. So I started to think of it as a metaphor for people. And also, process-wise, I wanted to move into more three dimensions. So we started to, with a small team of animators, create these animations, and then take the individual frames of those computer-generated 3D animations and place them precisely to create these sculptures that were then 3D printed and hand-painted and textured. And this is 2008, this is going on. And so for the film Bellows March, created about 18 different sculptures that were like different scenes in the film. And like Copenhagen Cycles, I'd bring those into the studio and spin them and shoot them. And I was really interested in bridging like the digital and physical world, creating something in digital space, and then through the new process of digital fabrication, bringing that digital creation into the real world and applying like handmade processes. So this is the film, The Bellows March, also comprised of all live-action shots of spinning sculptures. So likewise, while the film was being created, I showed some of the sculptures as like a work in progress, kind of behind the scenes of how I was making the film. This is at SIGGRAPH in Los Angeles, which is like a big computer graphics convention. They also have like an art gallery section. So yeah, on the outside you see the live images of the spinning sculptures, and you go behind the curtain and see what's creating the animation. And while I was at SIGGRAPH, the group in the booth next to me, they had created these things they called stop motion glasses. And they were flickering liquid crystal glasses that would go opaque and clear in frequency. And they were able to program them to flicker at a certain rate. And it doesn't really capture it here in the video because it's all, of course, two-dimensional. But looking through the glasses, you saw the full three dimensions of the sculpture, looking with both your eyes in stereo. So I started to think about really creating work that would end up as sculpture and not film, instead of flattening on the screen, showing it as sculpture. And I began to show the sculptures from that project this way. And then showed some of the Copenhagen Cycles work as well, using the liquid crystal shutter glasses, so that, again, sculpture could be seen as sculpture and not transformed into the flatness of the screen. And so this got me really excited about like all the different ways that zoetropes could exist in the world. And so I started to make different zoetrope objects, like the zoetrope LP record. And so these are just some pre-existing images I have just as a test. And the zoetrope hot air balloon, this is like a small scale prototype. Testing out what inks would work on the fabric and what kind of images would work well. Found that like some inks cracked on the surface and higher contrast images work better than low contrast images. And around that time I went to Shanghai to teach a workshop on making zoetropes. And I had some time to go around the city and shoot some of the moving elements in the city.
Turn and point up.
And I had my students bring their favorite aerosols to class.
How do you say spin?
And do different motions in front of the camera with their favorite umbrellas. And so I realized that the umbrella itself could be a zoetrope. And I did this test umbrella, umbrella zoetrope. So really going through like many different forms of how these things could be manifested. And going through all these like, you know, very like working through different forms and a lot of technical issues that had to be worked around with the Bellows margins, so on. I really wanted to, again, I was wanting to get back into physical spaces and work very simply. So for a period of time, I worked almost exclusively in physical spaces. And with this project, geotropes, I just came up with a bunch of measurements and angles to weave whack into the landscape. And then hire some friends to shoot a photo of the shape in the air with the drone. You can see the shape in the landscape there. It just works off the simple idea of parallax. This is really strictly an experiment. But then I took that image into the computer, that photograph, and spun it at different speeds. And then you see the landscape kind of tear apart and the different parts of the graphic shape slide against each other depending on what speed it was spun at. So again, keeping with the desire to like work out in the landscape, I went out to San Diego where my brother lives, and we drove a couple hours out into the desert and went camping there for a few days. And I tried to think of like what, you know, what kind of motion would I find in this place that was like completely devoid of motion. There's like practically no living things there. And it's a very, very still and quiet place. But I realized like as I was hiking through the canyons, that it was my own changing perspective that was creating the motion. So as I hiked, I took sequential photographs of these different forms. And then printed those sequential images out onto these long strips of paper. And this time I wanted to create this still image next to the animated image so that both could be observed simultaneously. So I think of it as kind of like a Western landscape panorama, but kind of a temporal Western landscape panorama. I think I've always been like augmented by technology, and I started working even as a kid. Spent 4 years in San Jose, California, during the boom of Silicon Valley when Apple was just first starting out, and so on. And I was making games on the computer and making animated images on very early home computers, and being exposed to films like Tron and The Road Warrior. And I think that my work was always somehow connected to technology or enabled by technology. So I started to think about that again, about things coming in and out of the computer, and thinking about Tron and the light cycles and how people from the real world were scanned into the computer space and then forced to compete in these video games inside of the computer. Thought of making an artwork based on that. So borrowing those very angular motions and the colors from the light bike scene, I created an animation in digital space in the computer. But I also had, again, that great need to sort of get my senses back involved in the work. And I had never been like really a studio artist. So I wanted to make a painting, and I had no business making painting. Never took a painting class or anything, but I tell about a painting when you see it. Made a painting where I followed all the forms of the motion with the paintbrush to create the painted work, and next to that was an animation that came from the painting itself. So by spinning the image in the painting, the animation is created. This piece is called Light Cycles. So, but something I was missing, I realized, and this came from, to me, well, going to New York with my family a few years ago and going to the Cooper Hewitt Museum, which is a design museum. If you haven't been there, you should go. My wife's a graphic designer, and so we all went to this museum. We had to drag our kids there. They did not want to go, but when we got there, they just done this renovation of the museum where they put in these big interactive tables. And so so our kids got like way involved in these interactive exhibits. And one was like you could design like a textile and then have the textile sort of printed on this big immersive cave wall. And that, along with the show I was having, a group show where I projected these spinning mandible covers on the floor of the gallery. And then I would witness these people trying to interact with the work, but they weren't interactive, and I felt kind of bad about that. It's like, interactive work is really engaging, you know, that's why about so many people are addicted to video games and so on. But I think some things you really have to come to, you know, for yourself emotionally before you really understand it. So I really wanted to make the physical sculptural work interactive. So the piece I worked on next, I really had me looking back at Edward Muybridge and his motion studies. And this Muybridge is kind of a common reference for animation artists, right? The breaking down the motion frame by frame of all these living things. And so I wanted to, what I started to think about was like, what was my earliest memory of being captivated by an animal in motion? And so I made this piece, Girona Octopi, when I was lucky enough to take a trip with a family, a friend's family, to Spain, and snorkeling there, I reached out underwater and almost touched an octopus that darted away and left a wake of ink behind it. So the octopus was the subject of Girona Octopi. But there's a crank box in the middle of this giant floor image and a live video projection, and as you crank the box, the whole image and the projection with you in it begins to spin, and when you get it up to the right speed, the whole all the octopi animate. And so this guy is trying to figure out how it works, which is kind of like a wonderful thing. Like after making films for a while, to see people like interact with your work and try to figure it out and engage with it in a deeper way. And so I took the opportunity, there's this big light festival, light art festival in Baltimore called Light City, and it's very well funded. And so it's kind of like an opportunity to fund some of the things I wanted to develop. And one was this synchronous strobe using like very current LED lights, which can strobe very quickly. And so this meant that possibly I could make a sculpture that people could spin, and no matter what speed the sculpture is spinning at, the light would always be in sync with the sculpture through like a sensor in the back. So I began this project called Shabamanetica, and it's a combination of Shanghai, Baltimore, Panama, and kinetics. And it was inspired by Baltimore dredging out its harbors to prepare for the giant Panamax container ships. You know, all these cities on the East Coast want the business coming from China, these ships coming in. So they're preparing their ports. And I had been to Shanghai, I had images from there, lived in Baltimore, so I grabbed images from there, and then I got the project to send me to Panama to collect footage there. And so I wanted to mix those three places together. And Shanghai is the busiest container port in the world. And then I discovered through making the project, I went to visit the Baltimore Museum of Industry and found out that Baltimore was once the biggest manufacturer of umbrellas in the world. And when cheap goods started coming in from Asia, those industries folded. And I had already shot students in videotape, students in Shanghai with their umbrellas. So it was like this kind of thing. I didn't know why necessarily I was making those videos in Shanghai, but then it all came together in this project where I went to the Museum of Industry. They let me make videos of doing different motions with the umbrellas there, the Baltimore made umbrellas. And I created these pieces that you'll see Baltimore made umbrellas flying over, kind of these ghosts of Baltimore's industrial past, flying over a landscape of Panamanian waterfalls, which is like the connecting point, right? And Panama Canal was recently expanded to prepare for these ships as well. And then you'll see my Shanghai students playing with their parasols in that landscape. But it's all activated through the public. that lady is from an old TV commercial for Poland Cats umbrellas that were that was the last Baltimore umbrella manufacturer. Experimenting with form for so long, and every time I came up with like a new form for physical animation, there was always kind of like a huge amount of problems that had to be solved. And I've been really excited about this sort of interactive animated sculpture thing. So I went off on that that form to create a show called Seeking Motion Hidden, which showed this past March at the Ronald Feldman Gallery. And it was really like all these ideas and put them out there and create these different artworks based on those ideas. So I'll just kind of go through what some of those pieces were. The first is called Empower. And the stars as our illustrious leader. Our images are illustrious. And it's that a leader's violent rhetoric empowers those with violent tendencies. And these are printed onto these polycarbonate bulletproof glass discs that are also CNC routed, or computer controlled routed cut around the outside, so also the form on the outside can animate. And then I also was thinking back to Muybridge, because something that always bothered me about his motion studies is that when you look at the male images, you go through the male nudes and they're doing all these manly things like boxing and hammering anvils. And as you get deeper into the female studies, they're doing things like undressing each other, pouring buckets of water onto each other, falling onto mattresses. He's not having guys fall onto mattresses, right? So there's a certain exploitation that's, you know, on permanent record here from Woodbridge, and I kind of wanted to bring that out in the piece. But also process-wise, Muybridge could only get a certain what we call a temporal resolution, which is like how many images per second are you getting? It's a very steppy kind of motion, right? So with current technology, we can add frames that never before existed and create a very smooth motion just using the original motion study images and creating warps between all those images. So I wanted to update the sequences in that way. And Muybridge was nice enough to pose for a number of his own motion studies. So I grabbed a number of images of Muybridge and placed him like a giant around these little boxes that contained a number of what I found to be the most exploitive female nude studies. And the piece is called Edward's Menagerie. Okay, so let me go on to this piece. That interaction, to me, I like the interaction, it's very simple. But there's also, I like the idea of exploring. Like when I make my work, it's often a process of exploration and discovery, and not really sure what the final result is going to be. So this piece is called Implant, and you interact with it with a flashlight, a strobing flashlight. And it's a giant medical implant that's kind of super magnified. And I have this degenerative retinal condition that's kind of making my vision worse and worse over time. So I kind of created this as a make-believe fantasy cure, like this implant that fits around the optic nerve. And there's little nanobots, cell-sized robots that jump in and out of the implant to fix things within the optic nerve. And so as the viewer, you grab the flashlight, and you explore the space of the sculpture, and wherever you shine the flashlight and see the animation come to life. And so the piece was made with fabric and 3D printed animation and some laser cut animation, little mix of processes. Inside of the sculpture, you see this kind of network of these organic and synthetic gears. And that also serves as a kind of a prototype for something I've been trying to develop for a few years, which is the zoetrope tunnel, which is a completely immersive, sculptural, animated environment. Where again, you walk through with these handheld strobe lights, and where you point the strobe, the animation comes to life. A long-term project, to say the least. But what I've been working on lately, along with some of the sculptural pieces, is I'm trying to get back to narrative a bit, and also music, because it's something I've kind of lost in the gallery space with sculptural pieces. And so I've been looking at performance and spinning like these zoetrope images live, and I want to do this with musicians, and I'm starting a collaboration with a musician composer on the project. But the first time I tried it out was a few weeks ago for a lecture I gave at my university. I decided, okay, instead of doing the laptop thing, I could do the presentation by spinning these discs. So I'm going to place you like midway through the talk. So there'll be about 4 minutes left of this talk. And I'm kind of getting into the story that, again, goes back to Moybridge. But this is kind of like a first try, this like narrative, DJ spinning, zoetrope thing, but I'm going to show it to you anyway, show kind of where I'm going next.
Lately, I've been thinking about performance and spinning zoetrope images live, like a DJ spins records, but I'm terrified of the idea of standing in front of an audience. Animation artists prefer to hide for long hours in dark spaces. Now, maybe you've heard of Edward Moybridge, the grandfather of motion pictures. Late in life, he also performed, telling stories and projecting sequences of photographs using his own invention, the zoopraxiscope. But most people know him as the horse guy. Moybridge's motion studies exposed a universe previously hidden by speed and the limits of human perception. He froze time. In midlife, he married Flora, who worked as a retoucher in the San Francisco studio and gallery that represented him. Half his age, Flora savored the city's nightlife and theater scene, eventually engaging in an intimate relationship with an adored actor. Now, this is going to seem like a tangent, but bear with me. This past summer, I was at an artist residency on the western slope of the Rockies. And hiking along the irrigation ditch trails there, I was transfixed by the common milkweed flower. Its pudgy complex of pink and white petals together formed a kind of frozen firework burst. I guiltily cut a flower and in the 15-minute walk back to my studio found that it had already half wilted. Thoughts of Flora immediately filled my mind. Her lover was murdered by Edward. The child of their affair was orphaned. And Flora died of what seemed like a broken heart. She was 24. Cut from her husband, lover, child, and beloved San Francisco, Flora wilted quickly. Flora's abandonment by the busy photographer, both during marriage, he was often away for months shooting landscapes, and after, he bitterly fought her attempts to secure alimony and child support. Together with my love and respect for my mother, my sister, my wife, and my daughter, moved me to create this motion portrait of Flora and for Flora. Now, this storytelling performance thing is brand new to me. I love that it brings us together to share an experience. There's something very human about it that isn't possible virtually or remotely. So thank you for sharing this with me today. Thank you very much.